So I'm gonna, I have 5 minutes, that's great. So my name is Hugo Frappier, I work for Civil Code as well, and I'm gonna do a small talk on refactoring. So I'm gonna give you, and these are my personal tips, don't take anything for granted. The code that I will be refactoring, it's one way to refactor, you might want to refactor another way, it's just an example. When you have a big function, break it into smaller functions. It's gonna make your code easier to read, easier to reason about, and you'll see an example of that in a few seconds. We typically use the pipeline at the entry point of a use case. So the very first function, the public function most of the time, will have a pipeline, and then we can reason and see what's going on. And then in the nested functions, you can use, let's say, a with construct. If you have you have to deal with strange return values from other functions. Ideally, do not have more than 2 levels of indentation, otherwise it's not easy to read, and you'll see an example pretty soon. And use intention revealing names, that helps as well. So when you go back to your own code 3 months down the road, you'll probably better understand what you were doing 3 months ago. All right, so let's go and let's have a look at a nasty function. So that's a function. So anyone understands what's going on in there? Probably not. I spent maybe 15 minutes trying to understand what is going on here. There, I'm gonna leave the slide there just for you to feel the pain. And yeah, that's a, by the way, this is a code we had to deal with a few months ago. I changed a few things there to protect the innocents. All right, so the first thing that comes to mind is, what is this function returning? It's not easy. So probably the first thing that we could do, let's put a spec, and let's use type spec. So after you look at the code, understand what's going on, well, let's put it down. So it does return a product ID or an error, some sort. And it gets a list of product IDs, a user, a list of maps, and a map. Anyway, so at least now we know what it returns. So we can work on refactoring the function. All right, first thing I typically do is to move some code around. So we'll take that inner nested big chunk of nasty code there, and let's extract it into its own function. So we're gonna call it interleave. So so the code is extracted. Now we have less code to try to figure out what's going on. We have another big chunk of code, the one with params there. So those 4 lines, we'll extract those 4 lines into another small function. And we call it build search for new products and categories. That's fine. All right. So now we have less code to worry about. Next, here we can see that the Elasticsearch call is basically getting a user and a params, and we're building that params using the category IDs. Might as well extract that into a function, because those 3 lines work together. They have nothing to do with the rest of the function. So let's extract this into its own function. So fetch new products in same categories. Let's move all the lines in one single with construct there. And now we're left with an if statement, 2 lines of code, an else. And when you look at those 2 lines, they look like a pipeline to me. Like, you provide products to a function that returns a list of product IDs, and you pass that to interleave. Well, let's change it to a pipeline. So now it's a little bit more easy to understand what's going on. We get a list of products, we look for new products in same categories of those products, and then we interleave the base IDs with those new products. To me, it's more readable. And then, what is nasty now in the function? The if statement. When you read books on Elixir, you get told never use if statements. And especially in this case where it's a pass-through. So if the params merchandising equals true, we do something, otherwise we just return the first argument we got in the signature there. So Ideally, the caller should decide if it should call the function or not, ideally. But let's focus on just this function. If this is just for a pass-through, we might as well just use pattern matching in this case. So in the first version of the signature here, we pattern match on merchandising true, and otherwise we just return the base IDs. So let's go back quickly to the IntoLeaf function. That's another nasty one just by itself. What's interesting here, and it goes back to the presentation we had earlier on TDD, there was some test missing for that function, so I ended up throwing all this around and using enum.zip, and it was working fine. The tests were not broken, but looking more at the code, I realized that that was not a good way of going. So I said, well, instead of this, we could use recursivity. Well, first of all, I mean, what is this doing? We don't know. So sometimes it's nice to just add a comment showing an example of what it does. So it takes a list and another list, and it will interleave the second list within the first one. So at least we know what's going on in there, and then we can think about how to refactor that. So that is one way of doing it with recursivity. We could argue that it's not easier to read. But for the sake of the presentation, I'm going to leave it to this. Ideally, this should be extracted in its own module and tested in isolation, because this is the concern of a module, interleaving two strange lists. So, but for the sake of this presentation, this is now what we have. We have a function with a nice short pipeline. We have small functions called by that pipeline. And we have more line of code. I mean, we have many lines of code. We have more line of code than before, which was this. But I think it's a bit easier to read. So again, break a function into smaller functions. Use pipeline at the entry point. Use the with construct when you need it. Take care of the two levels of indentation and use intention revealing names. And that's it.